Hey, welcome to Rabbit Stew.
Hi, guys. Hi.
Friday.
It's Anna and Claudia. Wait, you're not Claudia.
Yeah, I am. Hype. Words are hard.
That is pretty Claudia.
Claudia. There we go.
Can we please gift shift that? Please.
Welcome to Rabbit Stew.
The random flailing.
Yes. And thank you for tuning in to Hyper RPG. It is Friday, which means that we are going to talk about VR and tech.
Heck yeah.
Heck yeah.
Friday's Rabbit Stew on Hyper RPG. Hyper RPG, a premium live broadcasting studio, full studio here on Twitch, which most of you already knew that, but there's probably a couple
new people.
There are lots
of new people.
People.
We just got some cool new followers.
Channel.
I'm sure a lot of you here are following for the Death Jam tomorrow, Necropolis Co-op Death Jam.
Heck yeah. We're
going to
hype the heck out of that in a second.
Yes.
But in the meantime, Rabbit Stew, we recap or we forecast the day's events. Forthcoming day's events, and then we'll talk a little bit about the Necropolis Death Jam because that's super cool and we're really excited about it. And then we talk about VR and tech news because it's Friday. Each day of the week has a different theme. This theme, Friday. Also, because it's Friday, it is Free Key Friday.
Get it? Get it?
Free.
Get it?
Key. Free. Free key.
Get it? I get it.
Scott Rotti.
Ooh.
Thank you for being a friend, computer, and following.
And as a reminder, 5 is an important number here. Kanekineko, thank you for following. 5 is an important number on Rabbit Stew because 5 subscribers, and we give away a Steam key. $5 is how much it costs to...
Excuse me?
What? What did I do?
It's Freaky Friday.
Right.
We just talked
we
about
did.
That.
Oh. And
however,
however, we also get 5 keys,
all right,
every 5 one an extra key gets given
Ry-Ry,
away.
Ry-Ry, the interrupting guy.
Seriously,
I just am starred for attention. That's the only way to explain it.
$5 to talk to us through. Friend computer.
The friend computer, yeah.
Friend computer. Send us a message. Tell us how excited you are for the Necropolis Co-op Death Jam.
And just 1 penny less than 5 is the subscription fee.
Indeed.
Also, 5, when you do this, you can make grabby hands. And that's fun. Grabby hands.
Rah! Sorry, I scratched.
My grabby hand doesn't want to fight your grabby hand.
My
grabby hand is friendly.
A very aggressive grabby hand.
All right. So, that's what we're here all about today. Now, what about tomorrow? Let's skip everything that's going on today because we're so excited about what's going on tomorrow. There are signs up everywhere. We've redone the entry hall so that it's warm and inviting aside from Zach sitting on the couch right when you walk in. It's very warm and inviting.
No, he's going to try tomorrow.
Well, he's got that really hard working look on his face where
he's very busy.
It's very, very focused. Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So
if you don't know what the Necropolis Co-op Death Jam is, it is an event where we are bringing 20 of your favorite streamers like Man vs. Game, DJ Knight, Seriously Clara, Tessichka, tons of people. They're going to come and compete in this Death Jam. They're going to play in teams of 4, and they're going to run through the game Necropolis, which is a roguelike, and it is a dungeon delving game. It's procedurally generated. And they're gonna try to last.
I'm excited that Jessica Marzipan's gonna be here.
Yeah, Jessica Marzipan is gonna be here.
Because she's swell.
We like her a lot.
Yeah.
And they're gonna compete for glory and swag and brazen head trophies and bragging rights.
And bragging rights. Bragging rights are the most important part, of course.
Indeed.
In any competitive esport type event.
Yes. Also, I would like to note that we have a really fucking awesome t-shirt now. For the event, and it is specifically for this event. It is only here this weekend.
Ooh.
So it is super limited edition.
I haven't seen the shirt design yet.
It's so
pretty.
So
I'm not looking yet. I'm not looking until it's ready.
All right.
Is it ready?
It's almost ready.
Okay, let me know.
All right. Harebrained Schemes designed this for Hyper RPG and the Necropolis Death Jam. Hello. Let's load. There you go. All right. Boom.
You ready?
Yeah.
I love it.
Oh, it's so cool.
It is. That is a really cool shirt.
It's super cool.
I like it.
So, like I said, it's only available until Sunday. 2 hours, or 2 days, 6 hours, 53 minutes, and you're counting down the second.
Hey, now what if I wanted that on a hoodie? Could I do that?
Indeed, you can. You can, and it's actually really cool on a hoodie, too.
It really
is. I'm thinking about getting the hoodie. Nope, it's only until Monday, or Sunday, not Monday.
Well, Sunday, Monday,
technically, if you're maybe in Europe or something, I don't know.
That's true. A lot of our friends here are European.
Yes, and we've also got a women's size.
Heck yeah.
Cut. So.
That's
check
one
that out.
Thing that is actually more difficult than you would think to pull off. Like, having women's sizes of shirts. MDC4TR, thank you for being a friend, computer, and following. It's Mad Catter.
Yep.
Thank you for being a friend, computer, and following.
Oh, it's a subscriber!
Hello.
Dizardy!
Friend Computer welcomes a new thumper.
Dizardy!
For science.
Hey, thank you so much for subscribing. We got to give you a job on the Yojimbo.
Okay, you can do that.
And we give away a key.
And we give away a key.
Because it's Free Key Friday.
Free Key Friday.
And we give away a key every time there's a subscriber on Free Key
Friday. Dodging ahead really quick.
Yeah.
Who's our guest later today? Because we have keys for them, too.
Oh, that's true. Our guest is... Universe Sandbox 2.
Universe Sandbox 2, which is amazing in VR, and we'll talk about that later.
Yes.
But, yay, hype.
Yay.
Hyper rapid power.
Go.
Yeah.
Let's give him a position on the Yojimbo.
I think you should do that because I'm awful at it.
Okay, all right.
I'm just terrible at that. I think I had somebody cleaning.
You are.
Or something. It didn't make sense.
Dizardy. Let's talk. Okay, you are. The official dungeon master.
No.
Oh.
No, that's too good. That's OP.
Too good?
That's OP. That's way OP.
The official dungeon master.
Way OP, please nerf.
Of the, what do you call them?
I was going to say the official dungeon scrambler.
Scrambler?
For the gauntlet.
Oh, I like that.
Except that's...
Yeah, I am.
We know that, Joe. but thank you for rubbing that in.
Thank you.
Joe says we're terrible at this.
Yeah, no.
We do not disagree.
I don't disagree. You're the dungeon scrambler for the gauntlet.
Sure.
I like that.
The dungeon scrambler for the gauntlet.
Okay.
Which isn't actually as cool as it sounds. You're actually making scrambled eggs for all of the gladiators.
You actually work in the kitchen.
Before the gauntlet.
Nice.
It's not actually the dungeon scrambling so much as the scrambling of the eggs for the gauntlet. Gladiators.
Yes.
Sorry.
It's okay. All right. Let's talk a little bit about what is going on today. We have gotten you sufficiently hyped for tomorrow. We are going to continue to hype you the heck up. For the Necropolis Co-op Death Jam.
Hype.
All of the day.
Hype. Oh,
burr, burr,
oh
burr.
That. Yeah, that. No, so we were talking about the t-shirt designs. It's actually really difficult to find a vendor that does women's sizes and
true.
Decent quality shirts. Teespring does do that. That's one of the reasons that Twitch goes with them. That's one of the reasons that Twitch channels continue to use them very frequently, is because they offer that variety and still a decent quality more often than not.
Yep. So, like we said, we've got Dan Dixon coming from Universe Sandbox team. He is the creator, and he's going to talk to us about the game. They've got a version in VR now, so that's pretty cool, and we're going to talk about it. We can't play it because we are in the wrong room, but it's going
to
be great.
And bring in some keys to give away.
Oh, yeah. We've got 3 keys for Universe Sandbox
to
give away, and
we'll
it's going to
be
pretty great.
We'll get some of that mixed into the Free Key Friday, giveaway stuff.
Yes.
It'll be great. I see we've got the new emote approved already.
Oh, yeah. We've got 2
That's
new
us,
Necropolis
right?
emotes, so I would like to see those, please. Everybody show me your Necropolis emotes.
Necropolis attack. That doesn't really...
Yeah.
Necropolis. Hey, guys. Death Jam.
Yeah.
It's a death jam. Come on, that's awesome.
I like it.
That's brilliant, okay? It's
brilliant.
Like
we need some metal
I like
playing
this.
In the background.
I like them.
All right, then, at 3 o'clock, we've got Weekly Affirmations. It is our positive feel-good show, and we explore free-form RPGs with Strix. And this week's game is really cool. It's called Treehouse Dreams, and basically, it's this... co-op game where a bunch of people come together and they try to... Ooh, look at that death jam, you guys. That's real good.
Yeah, there's a death jam going on.
Death jam.
It does sound like we should have like hard metal instead of smooth jazz playing. I agree. Death Jam. Death Jam is our heavy metal band.
Yeah.
I was going to say our cover band, and I'm like, heavy metal cover band?
Yeah.
Emily and I, not so great with the improv today. See, I can't do that. I just put lipstick on, and it, my hair keeps getting stuck in it. All right. Okay, No more Death Jam.
Weekly Affirmations is really cool. It's this thing where it's called Treehouse Dreams, and basically this group of people is going to create an imaginary treehouse together. And Death Stew. So that should be pretty great. Then, Death from Above, our Battletech show, where we blow up custom 3D mechs. It's going to be awesome. So much death and destruction.
From above.
Getting a double dose of Don Thacker today.
Double dose of Don?
Yes. We had...
the Don double dose.
Yeah, and then Emily had neck issues.
Can we have Don doing double Dutch during Death from Above?
Double Don Dutch. What?
Don does double Dutch.
Yes.
That should be a show. Don does double Dutch.
So tonight he's going to be our villain.
Doubtful.
This week's episode, Corifee has some information that can lead the Marauders to the Benefactor, but it's at a price. So let's talk about the DFA link. Yeah, dun, dun, dun. We've got some new mechs and toys for the Marauders. So let's go over those.
Huh?
All right.
Pipe.
Let's get some cool stuff for these Marauders.
Okay, that's Necropolis. That's, there we go.
That's a nice little pop-up that tells you about the Necropolis Co-op Death Jam.
Ooh, fancy.
Which is happening tomorrow from 10 a.m. to 10 p.m. PDT, if you did not know what that is. Okay.
Fancy.
Yes.
Battle Master. I think it's easier to just say Pacific time. Because
sure.
PDT, PST, people get confused.
It's very confusing. Pacific.
Please
it'll be
tell
Seattle break. Time. Yo. Okay, we're in Seattle. Just
Seattle time, out. Yo.
All right.
So what do we got?
So we have a couple new mechs, and I would like to remind everybody that all purchases for DFA are collaborative. So that means that if you want to give $10 to something like the Battlemaster mech,
then that's totally okay. Then that would go down to $465.
Exactly. And we keep track of that.
And it gets updated pretty quickly.
It does, yeah. So don't worry about that.
It's mostly automated at this point for those totals. So as long as you put it in properly, it's great.
Hey, Sparrow Mech, how you
doing?
Good stuff. Welcome.
Good stuff, yeah.
So we've got new mechs like the Battlemaster and the Enforcer. We've got...
I am not familiar with those mechs, and that makes me super excited.
Yeah. You can't just say weird American time, because American time is like all these different kinds.
Yeah, we have like five weird American times, so...
Odd times. So, yeah. Not really.
It's no good.
No.
Funky American time. Time is, however, all relative. So let's see. It's in 23 hours? Mm-hmm. Did I just... No, not 23. 21. 21 hours. Because it would have started about 3 hours ago, 3 hours, 15 minutes ago, tomorrow. So
yes.
21 hours.
Yes.
Time, very wibbly wobbly, not linear. It's
super
just a big ball. Best description of time ever.
Yes.
I'm telling you. Anyway, honorable to a fault. With this purchasable, Talon suffers a +1 difficulty on all attack rolls against an enemy mech's rear arcs. So he shoots him in the butt. But he gains +1 if he attacks from the front. So he suffers a +1 difficulty if he shoots their bum, but gets +1 advantage if he shoots them in the face.
Yes.
Also,
Drone Network, Corifee can get some drones, which is pretty great. They're Gossamer drones. And she's going to have... There are two left. I think one has already been purchased. So if the drones are within 1 hex of an enemy, Corifee gains +1 to hit, and they get to move 4 hexes a turn. So that's a pretty badass
thing. That's cool.
I like that. Now we're just talking about time and how it's an illusion. And
it really kind of is. Yeah.
It is. Yeah, we live in a time warp here, so don't worry about it.
Hey, Emily, where's your coffee?
Left it at my desk.
Can we get a Rabbit Stew purchasable this week for coffee? You could have that. It's empty and has my lipstick all over it, but you can have it. We need a coffee purchasable. Coffee purchasable. Somebody suggested on Twitter that a rabbit stew coffee purchasable would be Zach making me triple shots of espresso. And I'm like, I'm pretty sure it wouldn't be Zach making them.
No, probably
but I do
not.
Have a spare espresso machine.
Zach's a little busy. All right, engine tweak. So. Oh my god, and you put more in it? Bye, bye.
See, you thought I was being mean. Totally knew he'd do that.
Yay, Rye.
That or somebody would donate telling Rye to go and do that. I knew one of those two things would happen.
Rye the Java guy. Thanks, Rye. You the best. All right. Engine tweak. Viking Less modifies the Griffin's engine. Extend Valravan's movement by +1, allowing her to get into the battle sooner and with less penalties. But she generates +2 heat each move.
Ooh. Wow. Wait, each time she does that, or yeah, each time she does that,
yeah.
Not each spot that she moves,
yeah.
Because that would be like, bam, you're overheating.
Hammer time has already been purchased.
I loved it
though. Hammer time was stop. It's time to repair the mech.
So when you are a certain age or older, whenever somebody says stop, you never know
hammer
if you're
time.
Supposed to hammer time, mm-hmm. collaborate and listen, or in the name of love.
Yeah,
it's really
always in the name of love.
Sure. Calyptus, thank you for being a friend, computer, and following.
And our last one, please.
Unidentified interference. All tech used in battle is subject to sabotage. This means that the drones can go haywire and weapons may require a piloting check to fire. I like this one because it's chaos.
Yes.
Chaos.
And Don is going to be here as our villain tonight, and I feel like he's probably going to inject a fair amount of chaos, and we should prepare our marauders for that. Because there's permadeath on this show, and he knows that.
We've already lost too many already.
Yeah, we have. Last week, Bronze didn't know there was permadeath, and she almost killed Talon. So let's try
this. It was epic. Hyper rabbit power, go! Actually.
Rihanna is ready for her coffee now. Hashtag as technology.
I seem to recall a little tweet on the Team Human hashtag saying that it was one Mr. Binky's birthday.
Oh, really?
Unfortunately, I doubt that the song is going to have his name.
It might.
I will text. I apologize for pulling my phone out. I am sending Joe his first name because I know it off the top of my head.
Okay.
But maybe Binky is in there.
Perhaps.
Maybe, but probably not.
Probably not.
Sending on Discord.
Da 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 da. So anyway, there are lots of really cool things coming up over the next day. We've got lots of fun role-playing planned for you. Friday really is a role-playing day. Pretty great. I enjoy it. Maker Space and role-playing day.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's two shows that are two out of three shows. Like
Two out of four.
Well, now, yeah.
Yeah.
So it's only half role-playing.
Yes. Okay, fine.
I don't mean to like
Aren't
crush your hopes and dreams
here
there.
Somehow.
Wait, no, not Binky. It's Chisley's.
Chisley.
It is Chisley's birthday. So, crap. I can't remember Chisley. Sorry, it's not Binky's. It is Chisley Wisley's. I'm misremembering, and I always do that. I am sorry. I'm a horrible, horrible person. It's Chisley Wisley's, not Binky's. Sorry. More coffee. The coffee hasn't kicked in yet. And I don't remember Chisley Wisley's first name off the top of my head. I know it.
It's Chisley. Here, I'll sing it. Happy birthday,
please,
Chisley.
Please, no.
Happy birthday. Happy birthday, Chisley. Happy birthday. My dog says woof,
Chisley
woof to
Steve.
You.
Thank you.
Steve.
So, I don't think he's here right now. So, I don't think Chisley Wisley's here right now. But Binky is, which is why I brought it up. But I screwed it all up. I blew it.
It's okay.
I'm fired. I fired myself, which means I'm going to go home.
Okay.
Not really. Do we want to do news? I don't know. Is it Sure.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
All
right.
Let's
keep the show on track.
Let's do some news. Totally thrown off now. Oh yeah, we gotta do news today.
News.
It doesn't work. The timing's still off.
Hello and welcome to the news. Today we are talking about VR and tech and exciting things coming out of that world. Today we're going to start with a story about the Juno mission.
The Juno mission.
You sound sad about it.
I have mixed feelings because it's a good joke, but I don't like the joke anyway. Because it's just not exactly like, oh, it's brilliant, but bad.
I love it. It's so funny. Basically, explain this joke.
NASA sent Jupiter's wife to check up on him.
Okay, the planet Jupiter has a couple moons that are named after... So Jupiter is named after the Roman god Jupiter, and his moons
Roman
are named...
Greek? I can never remember
Roman.
Which one's which.
I'm pretty sure it's Roman, right? Let's ask the...
And I actually studied this a fair amount in my youth.
If only we... It's Roman.
Mostly because I was there.
Okay, so Jupiter, the planet, has these moons that are named after Jupiter, the god's mistresses. And so NASA sent this...
Roman is right. Good.
Yes. What is it called? It's a... They sent a thing. Shoot.
A probe?
Is it a probe? This is very
Mass
Effect.
Sure, scroll down and we'll find out. It'll say in the first sentence. All right, the second sentence. Maybe the third. Oh, goodness.
Here we go. Let's just talk about this because this person's Tumblr post really summed it up for all of us. You know how all of Jupiter's moons are named after his lovers and affairs? Yeah, NASA is sending a craft to check up on Jupiter. You know what that craft is called? Juno. Who's Juno? Jupiter's wife. NASA is sending Jupiter's wife to check on Jupiter and his affairs and lovers. Fucking NASA. It's so funny. I love NASA. And their social media is like... Okay, does anybody remember?
No, their social media is pretty...
Does anybody remember this? So back when they sent the Curiosity rover to Mars... It was so cute. It talked to Britney Spears and they became friends. I loved it. Britney Spears tweeted at the Mars Curiosity rover and was like, hey, does it look the same as it did in 2000? Because in her 2000 music video for Oops, I Did It Again, Britney Spears went to Mars and she was a Martian in her hot, like, pleather jumpsuit. And she was a Martian and she was like, oops, I did it again. So she asked Curiosity how it felt, and it's like, hey, Brit, Mars is still looking good. Maybe someday an astronaut will bring me a gift too. Drobits crossed. So cute.
Your brand of science is like pop science. Yeah. It's like, ah, look how adorable this thing is. And I'm not yuck-yucking your yum-yum. I'm saying that's awesome.
How could you not know this about Britney Spears? That music video played every day. Goodness. Oh, you're right. It wasn't Oops, I Did It Again. It was a different one. I'm sorry, Britney. I failed you.
Right now, a bunch of 15-year-olds are wondering what the heck a Brit is.
That hurts my soul. Britney's still relevant.
She's not.
I still like her.
All right.
She's getting her life together.
There's something about being a Mouseketeer, I think, that sends your life down the
I don't know. Christina Aguilera is killing it, so just saying.
So at any rate, this is Rabbit Stew.
Yes.
Our daily news program where we highlight the day's events, the upcoming shows, and cover some of the news based on a theme for each weekday. This is Friday. Friday is VR, tech, and science.
Yes, and can you tell that I'm usually on the episodes where we talk about pop culture? I bet you can. right. Swimming cyborg depends on living cells to move.
Science.
Please tell me all about this.
I would, but I didn't read this one.
Then never mind. I didn't either.
I apologize. I focused on the VR stuff. It sounds really cool, though. I'm really interested.
Okay.
We can do the other one. I skimmed the other one, though. Wibbly wobbly timey wimey one.
Okay.
If you want. This one's pretty cool. It's basically that the placebo effect that we get from taking pills that we think are going to work, like that is a known quantity that actually happens. It's the idea that something is going to work is often as effective as the thing that's supposed to be working.
Interesting.
Excuse me. So they've experimented with bending our perception of time and the placebo effect that can be generated from that. Mm-hmm. So, and actually had some success with helping people control their blood sugar levels. So they took clocks that weren't normal, like they sped up a clock and they slowed down a clock, and they found out that they could trick people into better regulating their blood sugar. Like
tricky.
Like on a biological level, not on a I shouldn't eat yet kind of. So it was kind of interesting. I didn't delve too far into this because it was a little too biology medicine for me, which quantum mechanics. Yeah. I get quantum mechanics. That makes sense to me. Biology, failed it twice in high school.
Nice.
So yeah.
Cool.
But yeah. It was a super cool thing. And I'm always interested in how we can take that stuff into game development. And so that's especially where, in particular with VR even, we've got, last night I was sitting there in VR and it was after Ali had gone to bed, so I had headphones on in addition to the headset on. So like I was completely cut off from the outside world. And it gave me no sense of time whatsoever. None at all.
Yeah.
So in particular with VR, I feel like there are ways that we will be able to bend perception of time in ways that could be advantageous to the end user, to the gamer, to the person using it. So,
because like we said, like, time is relative and wibbly wobbly. So.
And that actually ties in with a later article that we're going to talk about using VR to... I lost the thought. I apologize.
That's okay.
Because I got distracted by...
by this really cool thing that is now really dangerous.
I'm totally yum-yumming this yuck-yuck.
You guys.
This is my favorite... This is my favorite yuck-yuck.
Yes. You guys, over 500,000 hoverboards had to be recalled.
Half a million hoverboards. Hoverboards, because I will yuck yuck all over this one.
Oh.
Hoverboards.
Yeah.
These are not hoverboards. These
are
ruined
like,
the name hoverboard for anyone who really
wants
love this
an
actual
subtitle.
One from Back to the Future.
They still look cool. Silly and still don't hover.
Yeah.
Because that ain't a hoverboard.
I will say this is a really cool device that I find very interesting, but I hate that they called it hoverboard and it generated so much animosity from me towards it because they called it a hoverboard that I'm just like,
just
you know what?
Just a Segway minus handles. Yeah, basically.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Which is cool. Is a really cool like technology, but
if
they called it a hoverboard, that made me yuck yuck it.
These... Okay, 99 reported incidents about this exploding or catching fire. Like within the last year.
Wow.
I know. Can you imagine being on one of those and just suddenly it...
Wow, this is sure getting really hot. It feels like the rubber on my shoes is... Oh, God! I'm burning!
God, that sounds terrible. Yeah, so basically the problem is in the batteries. Most of them use rechargeable lithium ion batteries, and those can be dangerous for a couple reasons. They're really cheap, and also people don't use them properly. So,
oops.
Yeah, oops.
Oopsie. So keep that in mind with your laptops, kids.
Yeah, you definitely don't want, like, of all things that are electronic and you use, you don't want a hoverboard to be faulty. Because that's, well, first of all, if it was a real hoverboard, then you would just, like, drop to the ground.
And, like, because you fall down, go boom.
Yeah, fall down, go boom.
Fall down, go boom.
Yes. Yeah, that sounds really scary. Do any of you have one of these? Did you have to return it? Because that would be a really sad feeling. Like, oh man, I just got my, you know.
I just rides one and I go, please don't burst it, please.
Yeah. Seriously.
Oh, that's amazing.
At the same time, when this does become an actual hoverboard, let's get one.
Yeah.
I want one. That sounds really scary though.
We're gonna be so old then. We'll be like, help me onto my hoverboard.
I don't know. Do you really think it's that far away?
For a proper hoverboard?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. Oh. Sorry. It's anti-gravity.
How old is old? Like
90? A couple hundred?
Like 90 or... Oh, really? That much?
If we survive that long, yeah.
I don't want to.
As a species.
Okay.
Krimi42, thank you for being a friend, computer, and following. We appreciate it.
Hoverboards are illegal in the UK other than on private land. Interesting. That makes sense. These look dangerous. Like, you remember when people were riding Segways all around?
Segways.
Yeah, like, that was dangerous, too. People would just kind of, like, zoom between people on the sidewalk.
Rip VODs. Incidentally, it is Free Key Friday, so any new subscribers, we're doing a Steam Key giveaway. We will have some Universe Sandbox 2 keys to give away later, too. So that's good. That's good. I think it's a ways away. I think that if we are rich, then we'll have medicine that will prolong our lives long enough to see it. But with the upcoming dystopian future, you're either on the right side or the living in muddy hovels side. Yeah. So
yeah, we're pretty close to dystopia right now.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
Anyway, on that note, let's talk about VR. Let's talk about Fruit Ninja.
This is far away. But we're not covering that news. We are covering Fruit Ninja, which is so awesome.
Is it?
Right. So have you ever played Fruit Ninja on your
phone? Oh, hell yeah.
Phone?
I played Fruit Ninja.
Right? It's just like that.
There was a
summer. You're flailing your arms around wildly.
No, there was a summer when I nannied and the kid had Fruit Ninja on her iPad because she was a 2-year-old with an iPad because I was a nanny in Chicago. And I played a lot of Fruit Ninja that summer.
That's fantastic.
She did too, but I was better than her.
So... well, yeah, she was too.
Actually, that's really not true. She was pretty good at it.
Wah, wah.
Yeah.
So, Fruit Ninja, I actually played this last night because I was going through Steam releases on what VR games have come out over the last week. And I saw Fruit Ninja and I'm like, I knew this was coming. I didn't know it was coming out so soon. So I bought it immediately. I bought this immediately. And then I played it and then I was like, okay, so it's basically Fruit Ninja, but you're swinging your arms around, which is cool, and I love it, but my arms got tired.
Yeah, I'm sure. That's just, like, basically everything in VR where you're actually, like, moving a lot is an actual, like, cardio workout.
It really is, because you're not just, like, you can't just kind of flick your wrist.
Right.
You are swinging your whole arm, and you've got one in each, and you're like, oh, I missed one, and you're flailing it around trying to get it. It is a workout. It is a serious workout.
What if they made, like, weighted...
It is a fun way to get that workout. Sure. Once again, it is another good way, entertaining way, to get a little bit of extra cardio in, a little bit of extra exercise in, while you're just playing around in VR.
Sorry, Megaloplasmon. Emily's new show, Are You Better Than a 2-Year-Old, is clearly in the works. The answer is going to be always no.
Where can we get 2-year-olds?
I don't know. I don't
with
know
their parents.
Yeah.
Oh, goodness. Perfect game for VR. I'm not going to say that because it is still very limited. I mean, I paid like $9, $8 or $9 for this, and it was on sale for like 20% off. So it's a $10 game.
Yeah.
And it is basically the exact same thing as what you would play on an iPad, only
except
it's 3D.
Except instead of like one finger, you're moving around.
Yeah. So, now that's not, like, I'm not intending to yuck it. Yeah. because that was still worth it to me. It was still worth that $8. And there's the potential, you said something in here, I think it was, how it's like being a court jester and having people throw fruit at you.
Yeah.
And while it isn't like that, I would freaking love that game mode where people are throwing.
You're just dodging fruit.
No, not even just dodging. You're dodging, or you've got the like, and it would be a super easy game mode for them to add that I would love to see. Mm-hmm. That would add that much more to it. Basically, you'd get a core workout as well as the upper body workout.
Yeah, I just keep thinking about like the additions they can make to all the vibe stuff. Like you could add like a weighted, you know, make your controllers like heavy.
I'm really looking forward to seeing the different peripherals for the peripheral.
Yeah.
Like the different add-ons to the Vive, because I will buy so many of those.
Yeah.
Because when this stuff existed when I was a kid and I tried to get my parents to buy it, they were like, no. No. I saved up for my second console myself.
Mm-hmm.
Like on a scrap little allowance that was like way less than it should have been for the amount of physical labor that my brother and I did.
I didn't get an allowance
and bought our console. So getting the cool peripherals, getting the little light guns and things like that was never an option. Well, now it is.
Yeah.
So I will spend all the money, because I also know that the more we buy into this stuff, the more Fruit Ninjas I buy, the more Fruit Ninjas there will be.
Totally.
And the better they will be. Yeah. And so forth, so on and so forth. So I don't mind buying in early.
Yeah.
Because it lowers the price in the long run, and it means that more people will be able to play it, more people will be able to get into this technology. And tying back into Fruit Ninja, one of the amazing things, one of the things that takes it beyond the app that made it worth, like, they clearly put $10 worth of effort and then some into this, because you look around the environment and it's beautiful. It's absolutely gorgeous. It's not like that picture that's up there, it's that, but in three dimensions. Like you feel like you'll be able to reach out.
Do you
and touch
walk
it.
Through the space, or are you just standing there like spinning around?
It depends on how you
like,
have
are
your
you
VR
going
set
through
up.
A level?
No.
Getting fruit thrown at you, because that would be pretty cool. What if it was just like everybody in the town hated you and they were throwing fruit at you and then you had to like
that
slice through the fruit?
That sounds really sad.
No, you would be the winner.
But
it's fine.
You don't win. You wouldn't. It sounds sad. The Adventure of Anna and the Reclaimed Childhood.
Yeah.
I like it. Let's do it.
Yes.
So
speaking of VR, I played VR yesterday for the first time.
Heck yeah.
That was pretty cool.
That was pretty cool.
I
wasn't there, but I'm sure that it was.
Super disorienting, but also I loved it. And one of the games that I played yesterday happens to be on this list from Kotaku that is the best PC virtual reality games.
I am really excited about this list because there are still so many really good VR games that are out there that I haven't even heard of yet. So I'm really excited about some of the stuff on this list. Some of the stuff I have played.
Let's go down the list. All right. Minecraft. That sounds pretty cool in VR. You're
so,
just kind of like stacking stuff.
The funny thing is Minecraft is such a graphically simple game that you wouldn't think that it would make this list. And yet it makes total sense that it made this list.
Yeah.
Because it doesn't require anything more. It's so simple, yet so complex that it is very well suited to virtual reality just
Megalo
by default.
Blazemon, what do you mean yesterday, Emily, you still have the VR headset on? What?
Sorry, Emily.
Nope.
I'm sorry, Emily. This is the Matrix. You're in the Matrix, Emily. That's not gonna help.
Yeah.
So
still
Minecraft.
In the game.
So this is Edge of Nowhere is one that I haven't heard of yet.
No, me either.
It sounds like a third person. It says it's a third person adventure game in the spirit of like Tomb Raider and stuff like that. So I'm going to check that one out if I can afford it.
It's really cool because you are going through the Arctic wilderness in search of this character's wife. God, I hope Emily comes out of her coma soon.
Why does it have to be a guy? Why does the protagonist have to be a guy? Why is it? That's really going to bug me in VR.
Being a dude.
Oh, yeah. Always having
How
to be a dude.
How do you know that you're a dude, though, I wonder?
You look down.
Yeah, I guess so. I guess, like, the hands or something. It'd be cool if you could choose.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
The heck with heteronormativity. Story could be exactly the same, just let you choose your gender.
Elite Dangerous.
Heck yeah. So, Negi Hama, one of our moderators who is currently in, like, Singapore or something like that.
I don't know where he is. Every day he's like, I'm in Hong Kong. I'm in Japan. I'm in this other place. And we're like, come back.
Yeah, right. He's the one that I talk to the most out of anybody about VR. Yeah. He's the one that I talk to the most. So I'm like, I'm right there. I'm like, come back, Negi Hama. I want to talk about this VR stuff. But he described this as a religious experience. Now, I love Elite Dangerous, and I've played Elite Dangerous since just after Alpha. I've played Elite Dangerous. So over 2 years now, or about 2 years now. What month is it? Yeah, 2 years now. Almost exactly 2 years now. I've been playing Elite Dangerous, and it is an amazing immersive game, but when you put that VR headset on, all of a sudden you are in the cockpit.
Yeah.
And it is
pretty cool.
Absolutely transcendentally amazing. And as he put it, it's a near religious experience, because as somebody who grew up on the Elite series of games, it's something very personal for me and my experience with games. And then to finally be like sitting in that cockpit is just
magic.
It's amazing.
I keep seeing, okay, this is the Matrix, right?
That said,
I escape the Matrix.
You don't.
Okay.
But
if I heard messages from outside the Matrix, perhaps I could escape.
No.
Perhaps.
No. Because, okay, so you remember the movies, right?
Yes.
You realize that when they got out of the Matrix, they were still in the Matrix?
Yes.
Okay. Well, there you go.
But perhaps a friend computer tried to wake me up.
Yeah. Is there an actual Geek Fleet? Of course there's an actual Geek Fleet. Cripe's sake.
Have a good afternoon, Stavros.
Oh, goodness.
Stavros.
So that one's just absolutely amazing. Now, I wasn't really able to play it because it wasn't oriented right, and because I just jumped in really quick to see it, and it didn't quite work out very well for me.
Fantastic contraption.
I played this one a little bit.
Oh, yeah?
And it is definitely one that I want to play more. Unfortunately, I was having issues with my base stations at the time. Namely, my air conditioning was making one of them go wobbada wobbada wobbada. And when one of the base stations or the lighthouses moves when you're in VR, it's like the fabric of your reality is being twisted and stretched and stuff. It messes with your head in a big way. And that was happening while I was playing this game. So I had to stop.
Aw. The couch looks rather realistic, though.
That is a real couch.
What?
The person's real, too. They're,
oh, yeah, look at that.
Chroma keyed that in.
It's so confusing. What's real, what's not? I don't know anymore.
They're in a green room.
It's okay.
Oh, dear.
Chronos. This looks pretty cool, but the things that I've heard about it are that it's sort of like just a normal, like, RPG kind of style game that you are in, and it doesn't necessarily take advantage of all the cool stuff you can do with VR. It's just kind of, you're in it, and that's cool.
Yeah.
Which is fine.
I tried loading up Ark in VR last night, too, because I had to redo my VR setup at home, and I finally finished redoing it, so now I'm just getting back into actually using it. And so I tried loading up Ark in it, and it loaded it in theater mode, where you are actually sitting in a virtual theater with a giant wrapped screen, and the game is on it.
That's crazy.
So I'm looking around in a theater, and the screen's still
over
there.
Are there other people
the
in
view
this theater?
Isn't, no.
Are you, oh, that sounds kind of nice, though.
Yeah, but
I love
it's not how you really,
the
like,
theater.
There's no point in playing the game, in watching a movie that way.
Yeah.
Sure. Playing the game that way? Not.
I don't know.
Really.
It could be kind of fun.
But
like,
that said,
I've got this space all to myself.
That said, they had tried bringing Ark into VR, and then an update broke some things, so they pulled it back out.
Okay.
And that's why it was having me do this instead of actually letting me look around the island or whatever in Ark. So, but it was really cool. But it goes back to talking about it not really taking advantage of the VR, where it was like, okay. Instead of sitting in my room, I'm sitting in a digital room.
Strange.
It was, yeah. It's like, great, now I can't reach my water without knocking it over onto really expensive equipment. Yay?
Sally says that she watched a Game of Thrones episode in a friend's VR in theater mode. It was very comfy. That sounds kind of cool, actually. Like,
yeah, that I could see. Like,
as long
actually
as you, like,
watching
or sitting
a
in a seat
or something
that has containers on the side, and you can easily access your water, and you can easily access your popcorn.
Yeah.
But it's got to be like, psh, psh, psh,
yeah.
Psh.
We will see, eventually we'll end up seeing a peripheral for VR that is a popcorn container, and another that is like a water bottle.
Yeah.
That are actual, like, dishwasher safe and stuff like that. Because it really wouldn't take that much to get these things to be recognized by the Vive and motion tracked and stuff like that. Because, you know, you see when you're in VR with the Vive, the two hand controllers, you see digital representations of the hand controllers.
Right.
All they would have to do is that exact thing for a water bottle.
That'd be really cool.
Right?
Guys, how do I get out of VR right now if I'm stuck here?
Guys, stop teasing her.
How do
you
I get
know
out?
There is no way for her to get out.
There's no way out. There's always a way out. I'm scared now.
It's fine. Audio shield.
I leave. You can never leave.
You can't leave. She won't let you leave.
Where is that coming from?
Me, right here. Hi. All right, so Audio Shield is the next one on the list. This is another one that I haven't tried because I looked at it and I kind of tilted my head like Kaiju, being like, why are you doing that, you silly human? That's what this one has made me, but everybody keeps talking about how amazing it is, so eventually I'm just going to have to try it and find out.
Can someone be my operator and jack me out, please? That's
no,
what Saint Escape
because
says.
They are all in the Matrix too. We're all in the Matrix. It's fine. It's fine. Just enjoy your dystopian future.
Oh, so I played one of these early access games yesterday. Gallery, Call of the Starseed.
Okay, I haven't played that one. I did play House of the Dying Sun. I didn't play it in VR yet, though. I have so many things to say about House of the Dying Sun. We don't have time for me to say all of them.
Say some of them.
It is still very much early access. I like where they're going with it.
Okay.
I spent about 2 hours of my stream trying to get the controls set up because I didn't have time to set it up beforehand, and I made the mistake of going live without that set up instead of just saying, I'm sorry, guys, I'm going to have to delay this stream again.
Yeah.
Whatever. But it's really cool. Now, Tyler, the GM for DFA for tonight, told me that I had to buy this game. He's like, if you don't buy this game, I will gift it to you. You need to play this game. And they the audio stuff for this very much wants to evoke Battlestar Galactica.
Ooh.
The current Battlestar Galactica.
Anarchy numbers. Thank you for subscribe or following. I didn't want to do the numbers. Sorry.
LXXVII.
Like a couple thousand.
I don't actually know.
Oh, wait. No. Not right now.
So anyway, the music definitely is trying to evoke the combat. The sounds are definitely trying to evoke the combat of being a Viper pilot in Battlestar Galactica, which is really cool.
That's pretty cool. I want that.
Unfortunately,
Sally, I know that you want that.
Unfortunately for me, because I didn't have the controls properly set up to begin with, it made it very difficult for me to, like, actually get immersed in that. But the art style is keeping it simplistic enough to do well in VR on a not perfect VR system while still being very aesthetically pleasing. It is still an attractive game without requiring huge amounts of detail. So that is definitely one to keep your eyes on. House of the Dying Sun is definitely one to keep your eyes on. I know I will be. And I also found out that they are a local. So we're going
to... Oh, cool. Let's try to get them on.
Yeah. So that's that's the plan there.
So I played the Gallery Call of Starseed yesterday, and you may have caught some of that because we started with a different game and I was just not getting it. Like, it was not a good first VR game.
What was it?
I don't remember, but maybe, I don't know, you're trying to craft things in space. I can't remember, I'm sorry. But it was very disconcerting. I didn't know what was happening. So I was in VR within VR, which is crazy. Oh my God!
Come on in.
Hype it.
Just
arrived.
Whoa!
Hype.
I can't drink it. Look at this. Guys.
Yeah, I can hold it, but why don't you
hold it.
Hype it.
Look at this. It is the Necropolis Jones Soda. We're giving this away. Special edition.
Only 150 made, right?
120.
Whoa.
Soda comes in packs of 12.
Oh, yeah. That makes sense. Okay. Yeah.
So you can definitely get a chance to win one of these tomorrow.
Is it strawberry lime? Somebody's asking.
It is.
Well, oh, man. Now I wish I could have it.
It's an unidentified potion.
Okay. I'm going to...
Sugar soda.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's not like fructose or anything.
I'm going to read the label to you.
I might actually have to try one. I think I might actually be able to have this. Oh, red 40. Okay. I can, but it'll give me cancer. No. I'm kidding.
So these are special edition Necropolis... labels, and it says, if there are no instructions, it must be safe to drink. Right?
Quote from the game.
Introducing Necropolis, an addictive blend of third-person action and procedural dungeon delving. Oh, and permadeath. Adventure alone or with up to three friends in a magical death trap that reconstructs itself each time you play. Will you find the exit or die trying? Spoilers, you're probably going to die trying. Yay!
Jones Soda!
I think it's super cool that it's cane sugar instead of high fructose corn syrup. Yeah. That's awesome.
No, Jones Soda is awesome.
Special label.
It's also going to taste better.
That don't ripple if they're in ice buckets.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, isn't it awesome?
That's super cool.
Guys, you know my feelings about soda. This actually sounds delicious, and I really want to try one. So hopefully I win one.
Heck yeah. These are awesome.
That's cool.
Okay, so that music is awesome. Now imagine listening to it constantly for 4 days in a row when you're at a convention and still not being sick of it after that because it's so good.
Wow.
I have to head out soon because we're going to do a studio tour.
Oh, yeah. Cool. Make sure you keep an eye on HyperRPG's Periscope because we're going to be streaming from HBS doing a studio tour with all of the streamers who are in town for the Necropolis Co-op Death Jam.
And it's led by April.
Cool.
/ Viking Lass.
Hey, Zach likes you. Can you get him to turn the AC on?
Oh, is that an issue?
Right now?
I'll take care of it.
I don't know, but I'm roasting. Thank you. That's super cool.
Someone told me that I'm 53 now and I'm stuck in VR.
Thank you for being a friend computer and
following. Mare, I swear that you're already a follower. Did you just unfollow and refollow? If so, that's fine. It's cool. Happy you're here. Apparently, I have a grandnephew outside of my VR reality right now. VR reality.
They don't know that. They're messing with you because they're in the Matrix too. It's fine.
What's wrong with you people?
And tell me if it tastes horrible. Thanks, Binky. That sounds wonderful. And let's face it, you probably will win one.
Tell you if it tastes horrible. No, these are really delicious.
No,
I grew up drinking this stuff, guys.
And I'm...
Jones Soda used to sponsor events at my schools, actually, because they're a local company. So that's pretty great.
Seriously, I don't drink soda. I don't like soda. I really want to try this.
It's good.
I think this actually sounds really, really good.
It is delicious.
With natural and artificial flavors.
So yeah, Gallery Call of the Starseed was really cool because it was...
photo, we like it, and we'll put it on our label.
That's true, they do have photo contests. So the Gallery Call of the Starseed was pretty interesting. I think I only got maybe like the first chapter done. I played the Solus Project before that. That was really, I had a hard time catching on to that. But the Call of the Starseed, I ran around and I shot a lot of...
Thanks, rules of the rules.
Sorry. I shot a lot of things. Bullet things? Not exactly. Flares. I shot a lot of flares into bells. Poorly, but I eventually got it. And then I was found at like an old dude who looked really scary, kind of found me and was like, follow me. But then he started shooting at me, which is pretty freaky in VR. But it was really interesting having the VR on because I've never been in a space that's quite that immersive before. And I actually found myself at one point, I don't know if anybody noticed this, but there was a spot where you're like on a deck. And I went to like put my arm and like lean over to look. like to start looking
that.
And I was reacting to it like it really was a place.
You want to reach out and touch these things.
Yeah, but then
and
you
then
can't.
They're just like, not there.
It's super strange.
It is one of the most frustrating things with VR right now is that it's so immersive Yeah, there is also a free Elite game on Steam right now. It's called Elite Arena. If you already have Elite Dangerous or Elite Horizons, which is the expansion for Elite Dangerous, you don't need it. It's just CQC, Close Quarter Combat, which is basically their arena fighting. It's dog fighting. You get into a ship and you fight a bunch of other people in a ship. And it's a lot of fun. So if you don't already have Elite, and in particular, you do have the Vive or Oculus, I suppose, get it. Get it and play around with it because, oh my God.
Sounds fun. Yeah, so that was actually my first experience in VR beyond a couple years ago. I tried the Oculus when it was still like demo phase and it was really rough. And I walked through an Italian villa. That was pretty nice. And my teacher, who was showing us the VR stuff, was like, let's turn on bird sounds. And I was like walking around this Italian villa going like, oh, look at all these masterpieces on the wall. I want to be in Italy right now. Why am I still in school? Oh my God, when do I graduate? And then I had to take it off and I was really bummed out. But actually, I think that's really fascinating that a lot of people feel depressed after they leave VR because it's such a like stimulating experience. And then you come out and, well, especially here, it's like, oh, I'm in a gray spaceship. I wish there were AA meetings for video games. There probably are.
Oh, there absolutely are. They're probably online, but...
That's true, yeah. But, I mean, there are support groups for pretty much everything. If you actually need help with that, we're happy to help you, because we support you. But, yeah. So, shall we?
It's true. All right. What else? Oh, this one's you, and also I'm probably going to sneeze in a second.
Oh, bless you. Bless you. Bless all of you. Stop sneezing. Do you want to talk about this you were pretty excited about?
This can be a really quick conversation.
That's okay.
I have been sharing this everywhere because it's amazing. Shoot that on over as is. And then, so this tweet, this is by a developer who does development for VR stuff as well as a bunch of other games.
Isn't it?
Thank you, Genova. And it's fantastic. He's talking about the different ways of moving around in virtual reality, because this is a big issue right now. If you do it the wrong way, you make your users very, very very sim sick.
What is the difference between motion sick and sim sick? Is it just literally that you're actually motion versus just a simulation? Okay.
Well, with motion sickness, you are moving faster than your brain thinks you are.
Okay. With sim sickness.
When sim sickness, your brain thinks you should be moving faster than you are.
Okay. I have experienced
the exact opposite. Yeah. It's rough.
It totally sucks.
But I feel like one of the ways to, and so this is a big, big issue in VR game development right now, is how we overcome that feeling that, and that was a big issue that I had with Elite, that one moment that I tried it, it's moving so quickly while I feel no motion whatsoever was really, really messing with my head a fair amount for the sim sickness. And so in like there's an article about Fallout coming to VR as well, and the movement within that is going to be challenging.
Yeah.
Because you don't want to just allow teleportation, but you kind of have to.
Yeah.
Even with room VR, you have to have some movement beyond that.
I wonder if they could do like a close your eyes for a minute, and then you wake up, or like you beam to another place.
I think, now this won't entirely work for Fallout, but I think that this solution would work for a surprising number of games. And so I'm going to load this up, and it's going to take a second. I kind of want to swap over to here, but that's okay. We'll see it. It'll load.
Look at it.
So he takes a toy horse and he jumps on it and he hops around the room. So using this method, you could actually move further in the virtual space than you are in your room. It's getting choppy, but we'll watch it again. Yeah. All right. So now he's hopping around and he's getting the motion from hopping around and moving just a little bit, but at the same time, he's moving further in the game space than he is outside of it. So something like this may actually trick your brain a little bit better than just like moving forward. And I think
cool.
It's hilarious. It's entertaining. I love it. I think it's great. I want so many games to have something similar like this.
In like Skyrim on this.
Right?
Or like whatever you want, really.
Yeah. And that ties back in with an article that you found about keeping VR games weird.
Yeah.
Like I think entertaining things like this, like he's got a lightsaber
and
he's on a tennis court and he's hitting these weird tennis ball headed figures. It's
with weird cloud skirts.
Yeah, with weird cloud skirts and hitting them with a lightsaber.
That's
it's very strange. But the point
But it's
is,
enjoyable.
Yeah, but the point is using these, thinking outside of the box for these locomotion methods may discover something really, really fascinating and useful.
Yeah.
Like really, really useful. So that was why I wanted to talk about that one. But like I said, super short thing on that front. We are going to have a guest coming in really, really soon for another game that I tried last night that I am super excited to talk about and very, very glad to. I knew like last week I was like, oh yeah, I should really, Negihama got me the Universe Sandbox too, because he tried it in VR and was like, you have to try this.
You must.
And I'm like, I need to do it by Friday. And I totally forgot why I needed to do it by Friday. So then I checked the schedule last night and I'm like, oh, that's why. Oh yeah, that's why. Okay, great.
Hello, Bob Laura Death. Welcome back. Sorry, that's what you came into. It was kind of weird, I know. But we're about to talk about more weird games.
Not sorry about that at all.
I'm actually not sorry either.
That was amazing.
I was joking.
That was amazing.
Sorry.
We show up from Lauren's stream to see this. Oh my goodness, did Lauren needs a raid. Lauren needs a raid call. Hi, Lauren Legion.
All right, so this is a pretty long article, so I'm just going to skim over it a little bit. But it's called Keep Virtual Reality Weird. And basically, the idea is that there is virtual space and then there's, you know, our normal everyday space. And virtual reality can be whatever it wants to be because it is virtual and you can make it anything. And it transports you to all these different places. So this person was saying, anything is possible. So why are we still trying to make games where you're running around being a person and like interacting with the world in the same kind of ways that you would interact with in general? And I think that that is a really fascinating opinion because there are two sides to that, I think. One side is, yeah, totally, it can be whatever it wants to be. But on the other hand, if you want to experiencing other people's lives and experiencing other experiences, helps us grow as people. And if you can put yourself literally in someone else's shoes and have their hands, that does change the way that you think about things. So that's my thought on it.
I think it's very much more about keeping keeping an open mind
yes.
than it is about saying we shouldn't do these normal things.
Yes.
It's saying, no, we should also do
totally.
This. And I feel like the article kind of misses that point a little bit
yeah,
because they're trying to drive home this yes. new experience
they're
thing.
They're really trying to stick to their thesis.
And it's like, yeah, it's like saying that you should only have Picasso art.
Yeah.
Because it's different yeah. and we can do that with art.
So,
and it's like, okay, but I like Monet.
Yeah.
I like Rembrandt.
Yeah.
I like
yeah.
all of
but
these other
artists.
But you
can like all these things and yes. they're all good and they're all yes. valid. And yeah.
yeah. So one of the things that it talks about is how a lot of games have been slapping VR onto things that they've already made.
BradLad69, thank you for the follow.
And how we shouldn't really be doing that, you know, just because it's cool. And I'm like, and I think that's a great thing because it's, you know, right now we have a dearth of full VR games. We don't have a lot of full VR games because it hasn't been out long enough or good enough long enough or in enough people's hands long enough
sure.
for the full development process for companies to say, okay, there is
yeah.
Money to be had here such that we can keep the doors.
Yeah. And so right now, open. I think a lot of virtual reality is really indie because it's sort of,
yeah,
it's an artistic space.
Untimely
too.
Void. Thank you for being a friend, computer, and following.
I would like to remind everybody that today is Free Key Friday.
Freaky Friday.
So every subscriber, we give away a Steam key in chat. And if we get to 5 subscribers by the end of the episode, we will give away 6.
Well, like an extra
like,
one.
You know, an extra
yeah.
one.
Yeah.
Altogether. Sorry, that was misleading.
So, you know, echoing what you said, I think that VR should be used, amongst other things, for this weirdness, but it should also very much be used to give us the experience of being a different person,
yeah.
to give us the experience of someone else,
yeah.
of the normal experiences that another person might have. I think that that is an incredibly important thing for us as a culture and mm-hmm. as a society. You know, we had the internet that brought us together, but that let us find people that were more like ourselves. But VR can let us understand people that are not like us.
Yes.
VR can let us literally see through somebody else's eyes in a sense.
Yeah.
So,
well,
very
and
cool.
I think that that's an interesting topic because there's, like I was saying, there are two different ways that you can approach VR. You can approach it as, I want to be someone else, or you can approach it as, I want to experience something else. And I think that that's a lot of what this article is talking about, is about putting yourself into these really strange experiences that you wouldn't necessarily have. Actually, can you scroll up so I can read
Sorry.
That quote? That's okay. So it had a really interesting quote about how developers aren't layering VR over existing games. They're building weird shit from the ground up and finding
Micro
out.
Micromachine, thank you for being a friend, computer, and
what
following.
What works and what doesn't, and the result is a pile of dreamlike hallucinatory experiences that will save you money due to the fact that you won't have to buy drugs that week.
Wow. Okay.
It could be anything. It really can.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's really important. There is an important lesson in here. I don't necessarily feel like it was portrayed as well as it could have been,
mm-hmm.
as constructively as it could have been,
sure.
Because they really wanted to make their point,
yeah.
which is cool. But the core of it is still a valid point that we should remain as open as possible to new experiences within virtual reality,
totally.
Because it's an unparalleled medium.
Yeah. The article also talks a little bit about people using the VR space to do like music, interactive music experiences. I can't call them music videos because they're not really, but it's using the music to guide the way that you interact with the space and with all the weird things that you can do in those spaces. So I definitely recommend this read. I don't necessarily agree with all of it, but I think it's a really interesting opinion.
Yeah. Very cool. I definitely want to, while we've got about 5 minutes left before our guest comes in, I want to talk about this really quickly. There was an article about how Steam's data, there's Steam Spy came out, and Steam Spy basically tracks a whole bunch of analytical information,
yeah.
Among Steam's players, their ratings, their hours played, things like that. And there's obviously, you know, they were looking at it to see which was the predominant method of going in to VR with the Vive, the Oculus, and obviously Steam is going to be somewhat biased towards the Vive because they've invested in it. So there are going to be more things on Steam for the Vive than Oculus. And that's just what this shows. It's still a surprising number that are exclusively Vive because it's either exclusively Vive, exclusively Oculus, or available for both. And I am surprised at how many are exclusively for Vive, not Oculus or just VR in general. So that I found to be really interesting. But what really, really told me a lot is, there's tons of information in this that is really cool. This is on VRFocus.com. There's not as many are in early access as you would think. Because a lot of it's, you know, glorified tech demos to a certain degree. And I don't necessarily think that's a bad thing. And in fact, yeah, that's something that I noted here. Looking at the ratings, if you scroll down, there's a lot of stuff. 61% of the VR games require VR to do it, which I think ties in with this idea that most of what's there for VR is a glorified tech demo. We've heard this a lot where it's most of what's out there does this one thing, and it's like an experiment in using VR to do this one thing. But the ratings, the user scores of these glorified tech demos are overwhelmingly positive.
Yeah.
Which tells us two things. One, the trolls can't really afford VR. Two, that even though these are glorified tech demos, the experience is worth it.
Sure.
The experience is hands down worth it to spend $5 to have, you know, one experience that you may not even go back to. It's still being rated really, really well. And on top of that, now we're starting to see with Fruit Ninja, with A Universe Sandbox, with all of these games are coming out with VR in mind. With House of the Dying Sun in particular, it was blatantly apparent that we are getting very close to getting full games coming out for virtual reality, and that those experiences are going to be worth it.
You know, the thing that pops into mind for me actually is Pixar, because Pixar's shorts are always done to test out a specific function that they're going to implement in another film further down the line.
Yeah.
So like the Finding Dory film, the short before that was about birds, and they were testing the light mechanics with feathers, and like specifically the way that the feathers reacted to that light. And that's fascinating to me.
Yeah.
And so that was like a little tech demo, but you can still have quality and entertainment come from a demo.
Yep.
Like, just because it's a demo doesn't mean it's not a full experience. It's a demonstration of a full experience that you will then take and experience in a different way later.
Yep.
So I think that is really interesting.
Yeah, I think that it's fantastic to, and again, tying back to Fruit Ninja, tying back to Hollow Point and experiences like that. Like, I was playing there's an archery subgame in The Lab, which is Valve's big conglomeration of mini games, and it really highlighted that even short, simple experiences can be really, really enjoyable and really, really
memorable,
immersive, powerful. So I think that taking those tech demos, like thinking about how limited things have been now, and seeing that we are on the verge of being able to do so much more, and seeing how much people are loving what we can do right now, tells me that VR is going to be successful this time around.
Absolutely.
That it is going to push forward and be in the hands of consumers and become a household technology.
Totally.
Because we're there. Mm-hmm. We're there, and we're getting the full-on games for these things to represent it. So
that's awesome.
I think we should recap what this is, and then we're going to play a short video.
Yes, but really quickly, I do want to point out Silly Sunny's note. Emily, seriously though, I bet if you did get trapped in VR, you would have a lot of programmers and such coming for you, like your dad, all of HBS, and a lot of internet people. So I don't think you'd be trapped for long. You're probably in one of the most secure VR users out there. Thank you. I hope everybody would come for me. If not, I would be concerned.
But what if Silly Sunny saying that is just the program reacting and trying to keep you in it?
Oh my God. So stressful. Anyway, thank you. This is Rabbit Stew, where we've been talking about tech and VR today.
This is Rabbit Stew on HyperRPG. Yes. HyperRPG being a premium live broadcasting studio here on Twitch, full studio. Rabbit Stew, we recap the news every day of the week. Well, every weekday, not every day of the week. That's different. Every weekday would be Monday through Friday. Sure. Every day of the week would be Saturday through Sunday.
Yes.
Or Sunday through Saturday. Whatever. Anyway, and so we tell you about the shows that are going to happen that day, and then we talk about news based on specific topics. We just talked about all the VR and tech news that we wanted to cover for the week, and now we're going to bring in the guest. We have Dan Dixon from Universe Sandbox team here to talk about Universe Sandbox 2, which is amazing, and I can't wait to talk about it.
Yay! So stick around. We're about to cut to a video, show you a little bit of what this is.
It's so good.
Welcome back to Rabbit Stew. We are here with Dan Dixon from Universe Sandbox 2.
Well, I am super excited about this because I just tried this last night. So I loaded up. I had no preconceived knowledge about Universe Sandbox aside from the name, right? And I loaded it up, and I went into VR, and I'm like, okay, there is a planet in my chest, right? That's the first thing you notice, that there is a planet in your chest, and you have moons on your hands. So I back up a bit, because I'm in full room VR, and I back up a bit so that I can see the planet, and it's no longer embedded in me. And, like, the way the evening played out, now my fiance had gone to bed, so I had headphones on and I had the headset on, so I am like completely immersed in VR. No outside lights, no outside noises. I could feel the carpet under me and that's it. And what ended up happening is the experience was so unexpectedly moving that I ended up sitting on the floor with my back against the wall, just watching the effects of the different movements and exploring the controls and the different things that I could do. And it was just unexpectedly powerful and unexpectedly moving. And it's still in early access, which is possibly even more impressive. And you haven't been able to say a word yet, but that was my first impression that I've been saving up for this moment.
Thank you very much. Yeah, thanks for having me, and thanks for those kind words. I feel very grateful to be working on a project that I'm so passionate about and so excited about, and that in some ways I feel like we've perhaps only barely scratched the surface of what's possible. So in both the kind of the VR interactions and then also even the simulation itself. And we have grand plans moving forward, so.
Now it is very much a sandbox game. Mm-hmm. Do you have any specific goals that you want to work into it? Or is it just going to be this sandbox?
That is probably the biggest critique of the game. If you actually go look at the negative reviews on Steam, that's what they say. They're like, well, I kind of ran out of things to do. Where I think some people want more guidance or more direction. Other people are like, and I would say I'm one of those people who are just like, I love the open-endedness, and I like can find things to do unlimited, you know, nearly unlimited. I mean, there conceivably is an unlimited number of things you can do. My passion is in improving the simulation and the interaction more so than providing direction or gameplay. But that is so tough, something that we should do and that we are talking about doing, but haven't really prioritized.
And in all honesty, I think that doing those things
it'll help improve and guide people.
Yeah, I mean, there were different points. Like, I made my own goals, basically. I've tried creating a black hole. I'm pretty sure that I failed, but sometimes it's a little hard to tell. But making your own goals in that way, trying to make a something that's massive enough that it ignites and becomes a star. Like,
right.
Trying to do those things on my own as a sandbox was enough. Yeah. And I think that the only criticisms that I could possibly have are that at times I wished that I could do things like that. Like, I feel like I failed at making a black hole when I swear I put enough mass in there,
right,
into one concentrated space that it should have done it. But then maybe that's just my faulty understanding of astrophysics.
It's also possible that, like, that's a fault of our simulation where we're just not quite handling that scenario correctly. I mean, there are undoubtedly edge cases that things you can try that just do not work correctly. I mean, there's edge cases of things that are just totally ridiculous and impossible. But you're trying to make more of those things work more correctly more of the time is kind of like our perpetual goal. So
what is the most challenging thing about creating something so open-ended like this? I mean, just the fact that it's open-ended.
And that the user can do anything at any moment, you know, change the time. Mm-hmm. You can change the passage of time to be nearly whatever you want. You can spawn any type of object at any moment, at any point. And so just, getting all that stuff to work together. And the kind of the crazy combination of the physics itself. So it turns out gravity was really simple, gravity itself, like the simulation of gravity is really simple. And then trying to add in all of the other physics that's new in the second version, calculating temperatures and surface temperatures and being able to melt planets and a new feature that we're working on that we have yet to release that will be in our next update is roche fragmentation. Mm-hmm. And this is where If you move a moon really close to another planet, then the difference in gravity on the far side and the near side creates like torque that causes the whole planet to like twist heat up.
Wow. Yeah.
And then will actually cause it to then break apart. So it's totally beautiful. Wow. And amazing. But that getting that that complex physics to work inside of everything else and not break existing sims and has been a real challenge.
And on top of it, getting this all to run at a frame rate that doesn't cause sim sickness,
yes,
while split onto two screens, like this is, yep, the fact that you've done as much as you have is incredibly impressive and awe-inspiring. And you know, at one point when I gave myself one of these goals, I ended up like giving myself a moment of panic, an unexpected moment of panic, just for a second, because I think I created a supernova.
Yes.
And you get this feeling of, oh God, what did I do?
Those are pretty.
That wasn't supposed to happen. And all of a sudden, everything around me is just this bluish color. Hmm. Like from black, you know, starscape in the far, far distance to supernova, blue everywhere. There's like this mist all around you instantly. You get this moment of,
oh God.
Yeah.
Like oh no, I just destroyed this entire small galaxy and made a supernova. So, crap.
And Minker says, I played the first Universe Sandbox and I saw the trailer for this one and I was blown away by what this is capable of. So I'm curious what kind of lessons you've taken from the previous Universe Sandbox, because this seems much bigger and more intense.
So the first one was a side project that I started working on for fun like 9 years ago. It was just no commercial ambition. I had no plans of ever really distributing it or publishing it. And then I just kind of kept working on it and I was like, oh, this is good enough to use as a portfolio piece to get a job. So I put it up on the internet, started charging money for it, was selling a couple copies a day, kept working on it for another couple years. Steam agreed to release it in 2011. Mm-hmm. Sold more copies in the first hour than I'd sold on my website in the previous 6 months or something like that. And I'm like, oh, I now have the resources to hire a team and really kind of really do this right.
Right.
And so that's what I did. Brought on two people at first, hired two more people the next year, two more people the next year. We're up to like 7 full-time, 5 part-time, plus me. The question was, what lessons learned from the first? Well, so gravity is really simple and everything else is really hard.
Like, yeah.
Essentially, gravity is all that the first one did, plus some, you know, interesting UI interaction. I guess also the other challenging thing is like just how do you take something that's so complex and complicated and make it accessible and easy to use? And I feel like that's like, you know, in many ways I would critique our work is not, we haven't done a very, there's so much, we can do so much better. I feel like we've done a pretty good job. There's so much room for improvement, and I'm like so excited that I have the opportunity to continue working on this and continuing to improve that.
Yeah.
So.
And I mean, we are talking astrophysics. We're not talking like candle making. This is astrophysics, if
hey,
I'm not mistaken.
Candle making is rather difficult.
But simulating it, a little bit less so. And I mean, okay, so being a super nerd, are you planning on working time dilation in at all?
What do you mean by time dilation?
So time is relative based on gravity.
Okay.
And so the closer you get to a gravity source, the slower time runs.
No. The short answer is no.
That's probably a good plan.
There are you could do some sort of things like where you could like maybe put clocks on things. Yeah, it'd be hard to make that work in a way. You could do some small things that would be pretty easy to do, but probably not. That would be a great question. So we have an astrophysicist on the team. She would be the one that would be able to answer that question more intelligently than me. I think the short answer is no. I know one thing we are talking about doing that she's really excited about, because black holes are actually her specialty, and admittedly our black hole, the handling of black holes in Universe Sandbox 2 is a little disappointing, being extremely self-critical. I mean, it's, you know, they're pretty cool. So it turns out if an object is in orbit around a black hole, if it's in orbit at the same way that the black hole is spinning, it'll actually speed up because the black hole is actually twisting space.
Mm-hmm.
And so we could, or if the black hole is spinning the other way that it's orbiting, it would actually cause it to slow down and actually like fall into the black hole. And so that's something that we're planning on adding eventually, that she's talked about that we're excited about doing. But
that's very cool.
Probably not time dilation. Yeah.
That's okay. That's but yeah, that's, there's like one person in there that's going, oh, that's a good question. And the rest of them are going, what is wrong with Anna today? Oh, cripe's sake, she's talking about time dilation now.
But putting like a clock on something, I mean, that's actually an interesting idea. And that might be something that would be fairly easy to do. So you could like put clocks on different things and then see like how different they were like at the end. So, but that it might not be more extensive than that.
Yeah.
But yeah, that could be cool. That could be cool to do.
And then why VR?
What
made you decide to bring this to VR? And I'm so glad that you did.
I had one of the first Oculus kits and then the DK2, and that was really cool. But it wasn't until I got the demo of the Vive at a video game conference about a year and a half ago from Valve, where you had these hand controllers and you were able to actually reach out and manipulate objects. Yeah. And I was like, wow, this is totally amazing. And it just kind of made sense that like, oh, okay, you could reach out and grab planets and throw them around, and so that kind of, you know, as opposed to trying to figure out like how are we gonna make this interact with just a controller.
Yeah,
but yeah, so the hand interaction like would just really sold VR for me, and then it just, I mean, as it turns out, what we were making just really made sense because it's so interactive in a sandbox and you can move the planets around anyway. You know, if you can move those around with your hands, that would, you know, the idea of like maybe being able to grab a moon and then like kind of like the Earth is here spinning, and you can like kind of like almost like you know, like push the moon into the Earth manually, or you know, or yeah, throw it, you know, I mean, like that kind of just really kind of interesting interactions that you would never have, like grabbing a moon and pushing it into a planet, you know, like
just to see what happens. Yeah.
So I, exploring the controls, like at first I had moons, I could make moons, mm-hmm. and that was it. And I made moons, and I was chasing after it. And then I realized I could fly, and I was chasing after it, and adding more, and then eventually I had this small star. And then I created another one, and I was gonna try and smash them together. And then I realized that I could grab things, and I threw it. And I'm like, well, now that's gone.
Satisfying to throw things in VR and not have any consequence to it.
I threw a star.
There's consequence to that. So, you're right. Okay.
Well, there wasn't consequence until later when I made the supernova. But
you know.
But it was one of those moments where like you're creating this super cool thing, and then you find a new tool, and it's like, oh well, that was simple. And then that's when I moved beyond that and decided, all right, well, now I've got this new tool. How do I play with that? And like kept expanding on my knowledge of the tools and what I could make. And then eventually I realized that I could just generate supermassive stars. And then I tried making the black hole and made a supernova. And that was my evening. How was yours?
Not so nearly that exciting.
Yeah. And that's the thing, like, you know, you're hearing me talking about this, and I'm like, when you're in VR, you don't necessarily feel like you're playing with 3D objects. You feel like you're, to a certain degree, you feel like you are playing with stars. And that's where
space god.
And that's where that moment of like pseudo panic that I had when I blew everything up accidentally came from. Like, you really feel like you are playing with cosmic objects in a sense when you're in VR. So it's incredibly well done in that way. So, all right, I'm good.
Commander Dunsale wants you to come back with your astrophysicist and play the game for an hour with Anna. That sounds fun.
That could be super fun.
That sounds really cool. Yeah.
Well, so we're actually a distributed team. So she's in Washington, D.C.
Oh, really?
And then we got two guys in Germany, a guy in Denmark, St. Louis, Philadelphia. It's near 3D Modeler down in Portland, near Portland, Oregon.
Cool.
So,
yeah. Does that make it challenging to coordinate?
Yes. It would often be easier if we were all just in an office, so we could just tap on each other's shoulders. Nice. And what's going on here? Yeah. But I think we also all like the extreme freedom that distributed team gives us too. So yeah. And then also has been nice because you know, the guy in Denmark, just super talented. You know, he actually has written most of our physics, and he had posted YouTube videos of work he'd done on planetary collisions for his master's in computer science, and I reached out to him, and I'm like, oh, this is amazing, and anyway, it didn't matter. It didn't matter that he lived in Denmark because we were distributed anyway.
That's
so
really cool. Yeah. So we looked at your website and I saw that you have done a lot of really cool projects like film and music and photography. So you mentioned that University Sandbox One was actually a side project. So I'm wondering, how has all of your passions sort of helped affect the way that you approach games?
Yeah, I think having kind of, in our both a technical understanding and an aesthetic understanding of both, you know, having written some music, the music in the trailer for the first one was actually a song that I wrote.
Oh, cool.
Although we've got, and then, you know, I drew all the icons in the first one. I was a art minor in college. So just that kind of combination of understanding of the technical and then I wrote all the code for the first one. Mm-hmm. And then also, I guess maybe just like being able to put all these pieces together in a way
holistic.
That they fit. Yeah. You know, has just been, I feel very lucky in that sense that I have both a technical and an aesthetic understanding and kind of can, and I would say I'm fairly good at kind of making those merge together well. So, and then in directing the second one, kind of that same, like, it needs to be beautiful. It should be, you know, both the interface needs to be really, you know, clean and simple and elegant, but then also the visuals themselves need to be beautiful and clean and kind of smooth and smooth transitions, and, you know, I don't want things popping in, like, you know, that's just been a, you know, like, they need to merge and they need to spawn or they need to fade in, so just like the smooth experience, I would say just, the technical and the aesthetic.
Yeah. Definitely work together.
Work together.
I love that you sent chat on a huge tangent about time dilation. They're all just like, we're so nerdy. We're arguing about time dilation.
Sorry, not sorry.
Yeah, not sorry. I'm sorry at all. This is science day, guys.
Science.
It's okay.
I think like what you were talking about, and I can't remember the term that you used because I'm only a hobbyist physicist, with the distortion of the planets based on gravity and whatnot, and then making them
Roche fragmentation.
Yes.
Which is a new feature that is not yet released.
Yeah. But I feel like that is definitely going to add a lot to the other things that you were talking about, and it moving smoothly and the different particles, like, and then speaking of the beauty aspect of it, once I realized how to make a supernova, of course I did it again from a safe distance. and it was stunning. It was absolutely gorgeous, and to like watch that happen. And so as you continue to push the technical boundaries that are of what all of this is capable of what people's computers are capable of handling and things like that, like, it's only going to get more beautiful and more stunning and more powerful.
Yeah, so. It's been really fun to take the guy in Denmark, Thomas, who makes the physics happen, and then George, who's in Germany, who does all of our graphics. So, like, the supernovas look amazing because George made them look amazing. The supernovas are actually destructive because Thomas set up the code, the actual simulation. So, like, getting the simulation and the visuals and the beauty and the beauty of what you see and the beauty of the math behind it, and merging those together is both a crazy challenge but also like super rewarding and super fun. I mean, Thomas had said that, like, it's so great that I can, like, just focus on making the math and the simulation work, and then there's other people that can make what I've done look beautiful.
So collaborative.
That collaboration of combining all of these different things is super rewarding. So.
And I think that ties in with how you've done such a great job. Everybody seems to be very, very passionate about their niche within developing this game, and I think that really shows in the product. I think that's that you can see that, you can feel that when you
Absolutely.
Get in there.
Now, on the nods to Ryan, who has written our music and is writing more music, so he's got some new stuff that we're going to be releasing soon. Nods to Chris, who's actually kind of written all the kind of the glue code, the kind of our core architect that puts everything together. Jen, our astrophysicist. John, who just came on fairly recently, has been helping with major code changes, and it's yeah, it's super great. So I'm just feeling, I feel very fortunate to, again, to be working with such a talented team and be working on such something that I think is just the coolest thing ever. So, and thanks for having me on to talk about my favorite things.
Oh, it's awesome. Yeah. We love having passionate people come on to talk about the things that they're passionate about. So you've been a great guest.
So with something this massive, I mean, we're talking about the fabric of the universe. This is what you were making a game around. When is it done?
Hopefully never. This is like, I'm more excited about this than I was when I started working on it 9 years ago. So like this, like I don't feel like I'm anywhere close to burning out. There's also, we've just got this crazy list of things that we want to improve. And like, it's hard for me to look, to play with it and like actually step back and enjoy like how awesome it currently is. It's cause like, it's hard not to look at it, just to run it and there's a problem here. This needs to be better. This is, that transition was awkward, or the water on planets doesn't evaporate correctly, which it doesn't at all. So when is it going to be done? We're in early access now. When's early access going to be over? I mean, the honest answer is there is no clear endpoint for any of this. Mm-hmm. We've got kind of planned, we've kind of planned out the next few months as far as like what features we're working on, and gosh, we're doing so much bug fixing right now, and then we're completely replacing our UI with a different UI system. That's coming up in like the next update, or like two updates from now. And that's just been a 6-month project that we've been working on this whole time. Plus then improvements to VR. So,
yeah.
I mean, I feel very fortunate. It's the product is selling well enough that we can keep paying everybody. We're actually hiring a producer and a simulation developer. So we're actually bringing a couple more people on. The answer is that as long as we continue to sell enough copies to support this team, we're going to keep working on it.
That's good.
It's fantastic. Yeah. And then when you're done with it, you can start working on the third one.
Well, I mean, there really isn't a plan for a third. I don't want to start over again. I just want to keep building on what we've already done. From a business perspective, it's like, well, it sure would be great to like be able to move to like some sort of subscription model or like some way of like, people that really love it and would happily pay more for it to just sustain development. Like, I wish there was some easier way of figuring that out, but in the meantime, everything's good. We're selling enough copies, just at a fixed price on Steam. You buy it once, you get everything. You get updates for free. So far, we're in good shape. So that was not to say that we're moving to a subscription model. Mind speculation.
Yeah,
but.
No, absolutely. Because there is that like, we want to keep working on this,
right. But
there has to be a constant flow of money.
Yes.
So yeah, it's the challenge of keeping a studio running.
Yes. But at the moment, everything is good. So, yeah.
Well, Dan Dixon from Universe Sandbox, thank you for being here. It was a great conversation. We really appreciate you coming by. Stick around, because next up is Weekly Affirmations with Strix. She's got a bunch of people from the Seattle storytelling games community to play Treehouse Dreams, which is a game where they are going to be also in a sandbox game, creating a treehouse together. So stick around for that. After that, we've got DFA.
Death from above.
We're going to mess up some mechs, and Don Thacker is our villain of the week, so that should be pretty fun. Stick around. Thanks so much for being here.
Shut it down, Joe.
Shut it down.
Please.
Shut it down.
Please. I'll share my potato chips.
Thank you for the follow, Magnetron.
Assuming we're still alive.
I don't know.
I think we are. I don't know.
Hey, Joe.
I don't know. Bye, guys.
Hey, Joe.
Bye, guys. Bye, guys. Bye, guys. Bye.
Light's still on, Joe.
Bye.
I think we're probably down.
We're probably still alive. I don't know, guys. Could you still see us? You could probably still see us. In which case, how was your day? Go on. We're listening. Joe's probably not even in the control room.
Someone mentioned Dyson's ring. That's actually something we're working on. So being able to
We can hop in chat and let them know that, too.
Yeah, putting massive rings around planets.
I think, is there any names left? Might be someone on your team.
Any names left? I missed it.
They were talking about I can't bring that up.
Hey, what's